Assalamu alaikum rahmatullahi barakatuhu, everybody, whether you're joining us in the space or whether you are watching live or in the future, welcome to the 11th session of the 99 names of Allah. And as you recall, last time we covered the names of Al-Hakam, Al-Adl, Al-Latif. Al-Hakam concerned the most fair judge, the judge that is beyond any impartiality and a kind of construct that we have, but is just beyond that kind of fairness and is the most fair, the most just, and the most fair judge in that case, who passes judgment. And Al-Adl is the most just, the fountain for justice, the source of justice, and the one who brings justice and gives justice. And Al-Latif is the caring, the subtle, the gentle. And we talked about last time how these names are not only are they not mutually exclusive, they all have a inward aspect as well as an outward aspect. So we see Allah is the most just. We see Allah is the most fair in judgment. And we see Allah is the most caring. But we see that we live in a world that has a lot of pain. We live in a world that has a lot of injustice. And so these names, first and foremost, call for us to use our divine's gifts, our divine's just natural attributes as a source of inspiration to then be these things in the world, to be fair judges, to be those who carry out justice, to be those who really care for one another. And so as we think about these names, we also think that the work we do, that's justice work, and it's been very relevant, especially given the conversations that have been going on this past year, to not only be advocates for justice, but in times of these moments of injustice, to not forget our sense of balance, to not forget our sense of having fair judgment, but also to not forget that sense of care, that sense of subtleness, that sense of being gentle with one another. So we want to lift that up, and we want to lift that up the fact that Al-Latif is not detachable from being just or from Al-Hakam. So we want to lift up that gentleness, caring, subtleness that comes with being just, that comes with having being the most fair judge. It's not something most exclusive. We sometimes think that in order to carry out justice, in order to be a judge, you have to be harsh, you have to be very strong, you have to be very coarse. But Al-Latif reminds us that Allah is the most subtle. Allah is the most gentle, yet Allah is the best of judges. Yet Allah is the fountainhead of justice. And so we keep that in mind for us when we do justice work, when we work for justice, we remind ourselves to be gentle with ourselves as Al-Latif is the gentle and the caring, and to be gentle with the world around. And the last thing I'll just say before we go into the Asma'il Husna is this justice manifests in many different forms. We, like I said, some people will be able to go protest, some people will be able to canvas, some people will be able to do so many things. I just wanted to give the time to remind you all that early voting ends in Austin in April 27th. In case you live in Austin, we have a really important election going on and some really important propositions that are on the ballot. So we want to be sure to exercise your right to vote. Early voting ends April 27th and general election is May 1. So please take the time to see what's on the ballot. Don't just be someone on the side. This is a really crucial election and really important things on the ballot, especially for those who are most vulnerable in our society. And as Muslims, we want to exercise our right to be there for them. And so we express that through those names of Al-Hakam, Al-Adl, and remind ourselves to be in the spirit of Al-Latif, of gentleness. So with that, let's go ahead and let's get started, inshallah, today with the Asma'il Husna. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen, and we will begin today. All right. And you may have caught this, but tomorrow, Sister Rina Al-Hanay will give the 99 names. So she'll be doing the recitation tomorrow, and I'm really looking forward to that. Today, I tried to get special guest Atif Aslam to do his 99 names, but we're having a little bit trouble with the audio that was coming in. But inshallah, he'll come back. So we will do that with him and have him do the 99 names. But for right now, we'll make suffice with ourselves as we have for the last 10 sessions. So alhamdulillah, let's go ahead and get started here. Bismillah. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم هو الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الرحمن الرحيم المالك القدوس السلام المؤمن المهيمن العزيز الجبار المتكبر الخالق البارئ المصور الغفار القهار الوهاب الرزاق الفتح العليم القابض الباسط الخافض الرافع المعز المذل السميع البصير الحكم العدل اللطيف الخبير الحليم العظيم الغفور الشكور العلي الكبير الحفيظ المقيت الحسيب الجليل الكريم الرقيب المجيب الواسع الحكيم الودود المجيد الباعث الشهيد الحق الوقيل القوي المتين الولي الحميد المحسي المبدي المعيد المحيي المميت الحي القيوم الواجد الماجد الواحد الأحد الصمد القادر المقتدر المقدر المقدم المؤخر الأول الآخر الظاهر الباطن الوالي المتعالي البر التواب المنتقم العفو الرؤوف مالك الملك ذو الجلال والإكرام المقسط الجامع الغني المغني المانع الضار النافع النور الهادي البديع الباقي الوارث الرشيد الصبور. So bismillah, let us go ahead and begin with our names for today. So today we're going to get through one third of the 99 names. So inshallah, today we'll get through the 33 names. And alhamdulillah, it's just been 11 days, but we've been really coming along here. And so the names we cover today are Al-Khabeer, which is the conscious, the perceptive, the knowledgeable. Al-Haleem, the gentle, the tolerant. And Al-Azeem, the magnificent. So we see these really wide, grand connotations and just awe-encompassing just type of names. So inshallah, let's go ahead and let's begin today with Al-Khabeer. So Al-Khabeer, as I mentioned, is the conscious, the perceptive. It means to know, to see all things and states. And we see this in so many other of the divine names. So you'll see a lot of overlap between the divine names, but each of them has a unique meaning, each of them has a unique output, input, all these different things that make that name unique. And Al-Khabeer symbolizes Allah's knowledge and of the details of all of the creation, so of the detail of everything. And the root meaning of Al-Khabeer comes from this meaning of to experience, to know well, to be fully acquainted, to advise, to inform, to explore, to search out, to ask, to discern. So a process of getting to know, not just that you know all this, but getting to know, to getting acquainted, to getting to know somebody or something. And there's this metaphor of knowledge and the ocean that was given describing this, that knowledge is not just fully attained from the shores of the ocean or from the foam of the waters as it recedes back, and the foam of the waves as it recedes back into the ocean. Knowledge and the quest of it is actually coming in the form of someone having that drive to dive into the ocean, to really go deep into the ocean and to immerse themselves in that water of knowledge, and to really keep going because there's just so much that's there. The water from the ocean can maybe, you know, bring out some things that the ocean holds, whether it's sea creatures or treasures or different things that you might find on the beach. But those are only things that were in the ocean. So you might get these gems here and there on the shore, but the real treasure, the real gems, are the ones that are still inside that you have to go look for, and the ones that are the most rewarding there and the most valuable. And this is kind of like that knowledge of that Al-Khabir lifts up, the knowledgeable, not just this kind of knowledge that we know superficially what's there or what might be, but we know the intimate. We make that effort to go in, and Al-Khabir recognizes that and lifts that up. And so most concepts that form the basis of this divine name are used on a daily basis in the Arabic language, in names, verbs, adjectives, and so vocabulary itself is a medium through which the divine keeps manifesting time and time again. We might not think about it, but how we use our vocabulary, how we speak, Allah's speech is perfect. Allah lifts up the most beautiful speech. We have the Quran, which is the speech above all other speeches. It's the divine speech. And so you'll see time and time again how commentators talk about the linguistic perfection of the Quran, the just unparalleled Arabic language that is used there, but also just in comparison to contemporary Arabic, how beautiful that language is, how intricate it is, and how rich of meaning it is. So it tells us that in our language, how we speak, how we talk, what words we use, we want to be of a nature that reflects the divine, and the divine manifests this in the form of the words that we use. So we don't dumb down our language. We don't water it down just because we feel comfortable with it. We use our language as a means of connection to the divine. And this is something we probably don't think about too much. But above all things, this name also helps bring clarity. It brings helping to cultivate deep understanding, not only understanding the consequences of things or the reason behind some things that might happen, but the nature of things that do happen. We come to find that people who incorporate this name, or when we incorporate this name, we take on a concept of mindfulness. We take on a holistic mindfulness. And in tying back to yesterday's names that we talked about, justice, and we talked about the advocacy and the impartiality and judgment that we sometimes are bestowed and sometimes we have to carry out in this world. This allows us, this name goes hand in hand, that we are conscious, we are perceptive, we are knowledgeable. How often you see this, I'll lift up the example of the partition of India and Pakistan, and the person who was brought in to help draw the line for India and Pakistan, just the partition line. They wanted to bring in somebody who was just, you know, on the fence, who was completely neutral to what's going on, just to draw it. The person hadn't stepped a day in a foot in Pakistan or India before and into the Indian subcontinent. But because this person was impartial, they went ahead and were chosen. And as you can see, you know, when you read the history of it, there was disastrous outcomes just because this line was drawn through arbitrarily through different villages and right in the middle of different towns and whatnot. So it was like, hey, this impartial person will make the best decision. And it actually was the flip, that somebody who probably would have been more conscious, would have been more perceptive, would have been more knowledgeable of what the case was, what the situation was in that country, in that subcontinent, would have probably had a lot better outcome, or at least be more mindful in terms of the advice they give the British government before leaving. But I digress. I'm just saying that this ties back to that element of being mindful, being conscientious, being perceptive, not removing that from the elements of justice, the elements of judgment, the elements of subtleness, to being mindful to not just all that is around you, but to yourself. So with that, we go into our next name, Al-Haleem. This resonates with us specifically because, and it connects with us because we just talked about Al-Latif, which was the subtle, the caring and the gentle one. And Al-Haleem also is the gentle, the tolerant. And this name connotates tolerance, patience, friendliness, kindness, wisdom. Al-Haleem is gentle, that gentle kind of love that really nurtures both on the physical and on emotional levels and the spiritual levels. We've talked about how these names of Allah don't just penetrate the physical, don't just apply to the physical or to the spiritual. These are names that transcend mind, body, and soul, and the physical as well as the spiritual. So they're holistic. And so this gentleness that comes about, it helps smooth some things out. It helps smooth the rough edges. It helps brings that which might be angered, which might be impatient, and it brings those back into a cool sense of tranquility. It helps bring those back down. So this gentleness is really a calming effect that it takes on, not just in its divine nature, but in, if it's taken on and it's aspired to by the creation. And it's a peace that arises from being aware of God's presence. So I do a class on Wednesdays, not class, it's a class, but like a support group for prisoners in on Wednesdays at the Travis State Jail, at the County State Jail. And the prisoners who I see, it's about 10 to 12 Muslim men. Some of them new converts, some of them have been Muslim for a long time. Some of them just discovered the faith maybe a day or so before I got there. And I went around the room and I was like, tell me what Islam means to you. And without fail, each and every single one of them said peace. Just, it brings peace. And most of them didn't even know the meaning of the word salam. Most of them didn't even know the meaning of the word Islam, of it being of peaceful submission, of just bringing this type of peace. They just said, it brings me peace. And so you can see that that peace that comes about from folks who have just learned the religion or are just learning the religion, the first thing they get from it when they intentionally take a step in is that feeling of peace. Al-Haleem being that gentle one that brings in such a harsh space as they've gone through and the struggles they've gone through, and in that gentleness to cultivate that sapling of Islam in such a harsh environment. And so the root of Al-Haleem connotates meanings of reflection, mediation, gentleness, forbearance, patience, insight, as well as understanding, reason. Al-Haleem is universal and all-embracing as a womb is for a fetus. We talked about Ar-Rahman coming and having that same root from the womb, the Rahim. And so this you see this type of this feminine language around this, but also just that loving embrace. You think about a womb, you think about just the tenderness that is there for both the child within the womb, but also for the mother that has to give birth, for the mother that is holding the womb. What toll does that take on that person's body, that person? And so Al-Haleem grants us peace at the time when we might feel overcome with anger and rage and like really strong emotions. It helps center us. It helps bring us back down. And it helps free us from feelings of lower passions in terms of like feelings of rage or feelings of revenge, feelings of the ego, feelings of arrogance. It helps really calm us back down, check our ego, but bring us down in a subtle way, in a gentle way, not in a very harsh way, in a subtle way. And sometimes we have these feelings of being misunderstood. We have these feelings of being abandoned and demeaned, and that's why we act out. That's why we may hold these sentiments. Al-Haleem reminds us how Allah is closer to us than our own jugular vein and our own throats, and that Allah is here. And Allah is not just here as a as some kind of consolation. Allah is the reason why we're here and helps provide that feeling of gentleness as well as just overwhelming peace. And so Al-Haleem, when taken in, really helps lead us beyond pain and grief and disappointment with gentleness. Think about just somebody, when you see the image of somebody helping an elderly person walking again, helping them, a nurse kind of just helping them walk again, or a doctor helping a patient walk again, or anybody just helping someone who's just recovered from a really strong surgery and helping them to regain what they were before. And just that manner of gentleness that they'd take. You know, you just think of how many folks embody this, and we see this, and sometimes it's just like, oh, that's such a nice person. We sometimes think, why don't we think about our God like that? Our God walking side by side with us and helping us get back as if, you know, we're recovering from something. If we're recovering from an injury or some kind of addiction or we're recovering from something, Allah is not the one that's there, the taskmaster behind us with the whip. Allah is there holding us still, holding us together with this gentleness, this peacefulness, and really lifting us up. And so we take from this name to really be patient and tolerant with others without ignoring them, and to be patient and tolerant with ourselves and others, and to treat everyone with respect, that everyone here merits respect, even ourselves. We merit that respect, and to not get caught up in these emotions that will bring out the worst of us. And lastly, this name, Al-Haleem, really protects us from distress in difficult times. It opens up those inner barriers that might have been closed because the outside world, when we have a distressing event, our hearts will shut down. Our minds, our spirits would kind of close off. They'll become hard. And Al-Haleem really opens those inner barriers, helps make that space for gentle reason, helps make that space for wisdom and discernment, as well as patience. And so we see people when we take in this name, when we manifest this name, when we lift it up, we not only are gentle, we're not only forgiving, we hold space for hope, for love and trust, not just for ourselves, but for others. Inshallah, the last name that we cover today is Al-Azim. Al-Azim is the magnificent. This name stands above everything, reflecting the one who always will be, the one who always was, and the one who knows no beginning or end in our finite terms. Al-Azim is the one whose splendor knows, as I mentioned, no beginning, and whose majesty knows no end. The root of this name comes from the meanings of to be, or connotates the meanings of to being great, huge, to enlarge, to be grand, magnificent, powerful, majestic, glorious, superb. So something just taking that you just see and makes you awestruck. And so it gives us a deep inner feeling of being blessed, of being satisfied, and a sense of like this divine, sublime omnipresence that is both external and internal. We are really just taken aback. We're really just taken aback by just how grand this is and how small we might be in the scheme of things, but also just we stand in wonder at our Creator. And what this helps us then strive for, what it helps us then recognize, is greatness. We see this in the divine. We see other attributes of justice. We see other attributes of mercy. We see attributes of love, see attributes of knowledge, see all these different attributes we've covered up until now. And these are things that we want to aspire to. These are seeds that are in us, and we want to activate them. We want to bring them to the forefront. And this name, Al-Azim, the magnificent, the great, beyond any measure, gives us a spark to not just recognize that greatness of Allah and in the creation that has been created by Allah, but that greatness within us and what we can go and strive for and achieve. And Al-Azim is that greatness that helps us process and helps us go from our own arrogance and go from our own false pride and our ego and overcome those which take away from our humility. So that greatness is not just us shedding humility and just putting that to aside. No, this is a greatness that's built upon the foundation of humility. And it gives us a stable foundation, that stable foundation of anchoring that enables us to be with Allah while really going into life's activities on the outside. We really get preoccupied with what's going on, what people think about us, what is all that is important to us. And we connotate that with greatness. We connotate that with success. We connotate that with just how far we get in life. But Al-Azim reminds us that we establish this foundation of humility. We establish this foundation of aspiring for a divine greatness that helps us free of those shackles from being judging from what is being imposed on us. And so all strength comes from Al-Azim. No life or death comes without Al-Azim, without Allah. And so we know that all of this is within Allah's balance, and that in this majesty in the limitlessness of the attributes, like kindness, like mercy, manifests that Allah in this grand majesty is not just something to behold and be awestruck by, but it's a reflection in terms of what we can, what sparks we've been given to help aspire to. That as it said in the Bible, I might have mentioned this yesterday, that Jesus says, be perfect for your Father and as your Father in heaven is perfect. And so teaching people to aspire to be better than they are, better than they can be, and to be better beyond society's measure, and to really aspire for a greatness, aspire for a perfection, which we can't, like I said, we can't touch what Allah is. That's beyond, because we've been created in that. But we hold steady and we aspire to that. And we then, like I said, with every other name, with every single name that's here, it has the inward aspects, but it has the outward aspects as well. So when you take on this greatness, when you aspire for this greatness, you lift up the fact that not only am I going to be great, but not just me, the people around me, the place I live, my family that's here, my country, my city, whatever it may be, the society around me. You're not just, it's not a race. It's not just, I'm just going to jet and leave everybody behind. It's you uplifting everything. So when you aspire for that greatness, you do it because you recognize the greatness of Allah and the greatness that is around you, and you lift it up together. So this greatness is not just a mark of somebody putting a medal around your neck or just putting a statue of you somewhere and just saying, hey, this person was great. Your greatness is measured by how humble you are, by how giving you are, by how inclusive you are of others, and how critical it is to lift up those other folks around you and to make them a part of that greatness, that endeavor for greatness. So inshallah, today we conclude with the dhikr, but just reminding ourselves of these names: Al-Azim, the magnificent; Al-Haleem, the gentle one; and Al-Khabeer, the conscious, that it's these sublime qualities that are really on this plane that we can't really put into a jar. But they're these qualities that help us remember that this is Allah in these aspects. And Allah has given us these seeds of consciousness and perception, has given us these seeds of gentleness and tolerance, and has given us these seeds of greatness. And we can couple those together to really become better humans, better creations, and inshallah, better creation for everything that's around us, not just to ourselves. So we conclude today, and we will start with the dhikr here. And bismillah, let us go ahead and start. Inshallah, we'll be wrapping up a little early today. So, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, Allah, Allah, Allah. La ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, Allah, Allah, Allah. Al-Khabeer, 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 Ya Khabeer, 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 Ya Khabeer. La ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, Allah, Allah, Allah. Al-Haleem, 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 Al-Haleem. Al-Haleem, 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 Al-Haleem. Ya Haleem, 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 Ya Haleem. La ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, Allah, Allah, Allah. Al-Azim, 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 Al-Azim. Ya Azim, 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 Ya Azim. Ya Azim, 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 Ya Azim. La ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, Allah, Allah, Allah. La ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, Allah, Allah, Allah. So brothers and sisters, whether you've been joining us today or whether you've been watching, please remember that tomorrow we have a special guest doing the 99 names recitation, Sister Rina. She's been doing some of our recitations of the Quran, nightly recitations. So definitely don't miss out on that. It might be a unique experience for Ramadan, especially you've been stuck with me for the last 10 days. And this will be a nice source of respite. But I hope this class has been a benefit so far. This session has been a benefit. Inshallah, we incorporate these attributes of gentleness, these attributes of tolerance, these attributes of mindfulness, and this aspiration for greatness and the greatness that we see around us in our everyday lives. Inshallah, have a good day and blessed Ramadan to you. See you tomorrow.